I just wanted to quickly welcome everyone to World Narcolepsy Day 2020. Thank you guys so much for all of your engagement already. It's been incredible to see all of your posts. And we just can't wait for an exciting day to raise awareness around the world. We have an amazing panel of narcolepsy experts from across 5 different continents, and they're all here on a Facebook Live with you. And so we have Dr. Mignot here in the US. We have Dr. David Cunnington in Australia. We have Dr. Yu-shu Huang in Taiwan. And we have Dr. Dauvilliers in France, Dr. Palazzi in Italy, and Dr. Bahia in Brazil. So we are going to go and get started with Dr. Mignot this morning to please share some narcolepsy research updates, what's happening today, and what kind of updates have we had in the last year?
Thanks you, Julie, for getting me the honor to start. Yes, I think this year is a very exciting year for narcoleptic patients, probably the most exciting year for a very long time. And I think the major, there's pretty much one major news. I'm not going to cover everything because I'm sure others will discuss other aspects, is the fact that there is now a drug that acts on orexin, hypocretin, that has been tried in patients with narcolepsy and is being shown to be incredibly effective on the symptoms of narcolepsy. This drug is a drug from Takeda, which is, there is a first drug that was called TAK-925, which unfortunately was a drug that you can only use IV. So it's not like a drug that you can use. But when it was perfused to patients with narcolepsy at a dose about three times lower than the dose that you give to normal people, it seems to wake people up to such an extent that they're almost normal and actually normal. And it wiped out cataplexy. And it seems really spectacular, which is logical because patients with type 1 narcolepsy, at least, don't have hypocretin. And so replacing it is really what we've been dreaming about. So of course, this 925 is not usable in clinical practice. Because nobody wants to walk around with a perfusion. Even I wouldn't be surprised if some of you may want to, if it was really so spectacular. But there is also a drug now called TAK-994, which is orally available and the clinical trials have started. So I would encourage some of you, if there is, some site close by to participate. I'm really I can't tell you how excited I am to potentially see patients, having their true symptoms reversed. So what are the challenge? I guess one of them is that this drug only acts on receptor 2. So what is the role of receptor 1? We know that hypocretin and orexin have 2 receptors, and we know that when you lack hypocretin and orexin, you just have 2 receptors, and we are replacing only 1. That's an unknown. But from all genetic studies, at least in other animals, and even in human genetic studies, it looks like the receptor 2 is more important. So maybe the receptor 1 really doesn't add much, and maybe actually it adds more side effect. It's very possible. So we'll see what happened, but I think that's one question. Another question, of course, is always, will there be some weird side effects? We don't know, but it doesn't look like it. It doesn't look like it's... addictive from human or animal studies. So I think it's very exciting. Another question is, will it be active on narcolepsy type 2? It looks like it, or idiopathic hypersomnia, it looks like it's effective, but you may need a higher dose. Another question is, will it work on disturbed nocturnal sleep? Because it's a wake promoting drug. And of course, patients with narcolepsy don't sleep well. I think there are good reason to believe that on the long term it will, but I think we'll discuss that during the clinical trial and the next year. But the exciting thing is that this is the first of several. There are several other companies that are working on it. And I have absolutely no doubt that that's going to be really transformational for patients with narcolepsy. So personally, I'm ready to retire you know?
No, not yet. We're not ready.
So I guess another challenge will be to try to find a way to diagnose narcolepsy better and faster. And for this, there's a couple of directions. One of them is to use some wearable, you know, instead of all this, you know, complicated machinery where you have to hook yourself up at, in a lab. The second thing, and using machine learning, which we have done some work on, I think it's a very exciting area. Another area that I think would be exciting is, again, understanding why hypocretin cells are dead. It's more immunology, but we don't really have any breakthrough. We are making progress. But I hope that at some point we'll have a blood test that could tell us who is at risk of developing narcolepsy when they get infected with the flu. And then finally, I was told, but maybe I'm already too late. You tell me if I should stop. But do I have a few minutes about COVID? Okay.
Yes, please. Yeah.
So for COVID, we actually did a nice study with Jean-Louis Pépin in France, in Strasbourg. We use actually this wearable to measure sleep in people during confinement and try to figure out what happened to them. What we discovered, it was the revenge of the night owl. You know, it's terrible to be a night owl in life, you know, because people force you to wake up early. I'm sure in Brazil that may be a bit different, but hopefully, no, some, I mean, it's always hard to wake up early when you're a night owl. And when you are at home and you are working, it's so much better when you're a night owl because you can wake up later and then you have a lot more REM sleep, for example. And that might explain also why a lot of people have reported more dreaming during the COVID time. So we found that this was a big, you know, finding of our study. And I think it shows that we really need to be more flexible in our work hours. And I'm sure that narcoleptics would really welcome that. Working at home, being able to nap when they want, etc. I hope that the narcoleptics, like the night owls, have benefited from it. Even so, I think they still need to keep a certain structure to make sure that that their life doesn't fall apart. So I would say these are the things that I just came in my mind for this particular event. And most of all, you know, I just want to wish everyone a really good day. And I want to tell them that we are all here to support you and to try to help to, you know, make your life better. And I'm very proud to be part of this group that's going to talk to you today.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Thank you for joining us and for all that you're doing. And we just hope for, you know, I feel a lot of hope too for the future and especially for the new treatments. So I probably won't go on it myself quite yet, but on the clinical trials, but I hope that we have people in the US that are participating and learning more about these. And thanks to our friends in Japan who were the original patients on the trials, I believe.
Yes, a lot of these studies were done by Dr. Honda, who is not here, but you know, I think you're right. We should acknowledge his work because what's good is that we know that they're good patients and it was well done.
All right, well, thank you so much, Emmanuel.